Back. And we are going to continue with another one of my favorite sonnets over here in the toolbar. We're going to look at Sonnet 73, that again deals a lot with time, with changing, with thinking, a little bit of melancholy, touching upon some of our class themes. Here's the video with Sonnet 30. Watch it, love it, learn it. All right, and I have. And all these sonnets too, I have one, here's the PDF of the sonnet right here. Here's another PDF with a few notes. You see my notes on it. And we're gonna look at the Word doc so we can play around with the structure a little bit. All right, here we go. Sonnet 73. That time of year thou mayest in me behold, when yellow leaves, or none, or few, do hang upon these boughs which shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs, where late the sweet bird sang. In me thou seest the twilight of such day, as after sunset fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away. Death's second self that seals up all in rest. In me thou seest the glowing of such fire that on the ashes of his youth doth lie, as the deathbed whereon it must expire, consumed with that which it was nourished by. This thou perceivest, which makes thy love more strong, to love that well which thou must leave ere long. All right, so you have the 14 line, the sonnet, and we haven't really looked much at form, style, structure. That's not what the class is, but we have the behold, cold, hang, sang, day away, west. We have a new rhyme here, west, rest, fire, expire, lie by, and then the couplet rhymes at the end. That's the Shakespearean sonnet. Let's break it up into the three quatrains and the couplet, which will make it a little easier to look at. Sonnet 73 deals again with time and can stand as a sonnet of self-correction. Think of how we're constantly changing, we're constantly in flux, and that's what makes Shakespeare, these sonnets, and Shakespeare's language, it can be difficult. We had a close read because there's a lot of intellectual work, a lot of philosophical work, a lot of changing going on. This self-correction, where we go back on what we previously felt, thought, believed. I would be, we probably know people who are stuck in their ways. Life is hard. Hopefully, we don't feel, think, believe the same things we did 5, 10 years ago. If we don't change, if we're stubborn. Life's a struggle, right? This sonnet contains three models of life, although he displaces them into perceptions he ascribes to the addressee. Thou mayest in me behold, in me thou seest, so thou mayest in me behold, whereas in me thou seest, this thou perceivest. They are really self-created perceptions. So the speaker, even though it's addressing the young man, it's a really self-created perceptions. The three models, think of this. Three models are a season, the season in the first quatrain, a day in the second quatrain, whoops, and then a fire, right? All are models of aging, but the structure of each quatrain is meaningfully different from that of its predecessor. The first two models are linear. We have spring, summer, autumn, winter, morning, noon, afternoon, sunset, twilight, night, right? In the first model, the first quatrain here, the speaker has placed himself in the timeline of the year at autumn, right? That time of year that mayest in me behold when yellow leaves or none or few do hang. We're in autumn. Think of when the autumn of our youth, right? Upon these boughs which shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs where late the sweet bird sang. So he's thinking of himself in the autumn of his youth, right? We're in autumn here. We're the bows or bows are bare ruined choirs. I love those three words, or I love that. Where late the sweet bird sang. The second quatrain, the speaker places himself in twilight, which is later in the course of the day than autumn is in the course of the seasons. So when we're in autumn, we're getting late, but we're not in the winter of our lives, right? Twilight is later in the day. So in me thou seest the twilight of such day as after sunset fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away, death's second self that seals up all the rest. There is a shorter glance back to sunset and a willing look forward to a future rest. This is more of a calm resignation. So we're looking, I'm looking back in the autumn of my youth at these bare ruined choirs. Here, that seals up all in rest. There's a calm resignation. When people are getting older, when we're older but not old, we still have this looking back. But there's this calm resignation. The third quatrain, here's a change, though, abandons the linear structure. There is a glowing fire on top of the ashes of youth, its eventual deathbed. In the earlier images, the speaker sees himself, presents a self-image. So the self-image are these bare ruined choirs. That's how he's describing himself. We're in the twilight. I'm in my twilight. The earlier state, the leafy boughs, the sweet birds sang, it contrasts. So these bare ruined choirs contrasts with the leafy boughs, right? And where the birds sweetly sang. In the third quatrain, he is glowing. So this is different, right? There's aging, there's falling away, there's nothing, the bare trees. Now there's a glowing, which is a positive word, unlike ruin or fade. A fire doesn't, it's glowing, it's burning. He is not the ashes of a fire or the embers. Rather, he is an action. So it's not the embers of a fire dying out. It's glowing of a fire. It's burning. And so it's such a contrast. All these sonnets, they're intellectually dense and difficult. It's doing a lot in 14 lines. This third quatrain contrasts mightily with the first two. How did this change take place? It came about by the gradual withdrawal from the idealization of his own youth. Think about that. And a lot of us, I'm older than you are, most of you. There's an idealization of youth. There's these feelings when we're young. I could do anything. I'm gonna live forever. The world is my oyster. It's I'm gonna take it all on. I could do it all. And then when you get a little older, it's like that thing when you're young, your parents, if you have good parents, you could be anything you want when you grow up. There comes a certain point when we know that that's, it's not that we can be anything. It's what can I do and what can I do? And it happens, it comes to do not necessarily with ability or drive, but time. There aren't enough hours in the day to do all the things we want to do, right? There just isn't enough time. Again, time. It's flying by, it's slipping away. And the speaker sees that in the first two quatrains, the first part of the poem here. Youth is a phase, right? Youth is just a phase, even though we try to hold on to it. But in here, in me thou seest, in me you see, in me the young man seest the glowing of such fire. Youth was a phase. Once it is admitted that youth wanes, it is clear the only center of life, of true life, is the present. So we're in the present here. It's glowing. I'm not done yet. I have a fire inside me, right? It still glows. In me thou seest the glowing of such fire. That line, right? And we'll all think of this. The older we get, we're like, damn, I'm not 18, I'm not young anymore. But damn it, there inside of me still burns this fire that on the ashes of his youth doth lie. those are just the youth is over. Now it's a different phase. As the deathbed whereon it must expire, consumed with that which it was nourished by. This thou perceivest, which makes thy love more strong. So acknowledging this, instead of trying to lament, hold on, look back at youth and everything it entails, we were stronger, younger, everything that we had, everything was more in front of us. That's over. That was just a phase, right? And here is the acknowledgement of the present. All we have is the present. Isn't that a bumper sticker? The past is over. We can't change it. The future is, we have the present. That's hard though, right? Again, like in Sonnet 30, these realizations, these acknowledgments, this so-called critical thinking, which is a college university buzzword, critical thinking, the ability to understand this, that all we have is this present. It takes intelligence, it takes intellectual, philosophical maturity, and it takes a sharp, keen mind, right? This thou perceivest, which makes thy love more strong, to love that well which thou must leave ere long. These are poems of address to a beloved. The speaker's appeal to the love of the beloved is at first an appeal of physical pathos, ruined, right? This is physical pathos, I'm ruined. And next, an appeal of mental decline, right? So we have the physical here, mental decline, the fading of the light. Our own body as a fading object, it mirrors the beloved here. However, when the speaker reads the text of his emotional life, the entire text, when one looks back and one looks at everything he, she, they experienced, been through physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, philosophically, there's a glowing. Everything we've gone through, it makes us who we are in a sense, and it adds those folds. Like, remember Sonnet 30 with the folds of time? These are the folds of life here. There's a glowing, right? After that recognition of everything that came before. So, think of this after these bare ruined choirs, the autumn, the leafless trees, which is the season. Then we have the twilight of the day, which is late, but still there is this fire, right? This fire that burns. And it's a solace, albeit a momentary solace. It's not forever, but it's the present, right? Right here. This is it. This is the poem. This is the still burning structure of the speaker's mind at work in this powerful sonnet.